So first of all, I would like to call Mr. Sridhar Dharmarajan to present his talk. Sir, please.
Good evening. So much of lectures the whole day, the topics are so interesting. We generally see that we don't get tired when we talk about things that are really interesting. A lot of speakers speaking about some of these new technologies, a lot of learnings for me personally as well. We have been doing a lot of work in the autonomous space and the connected vehicle space. And the 15 minutes that I'm going to spend here to give you a brief will just be a high-level things that we do. For more details, I would really request you to come to our booth. I think it's booth number 14. We can show you a complete detailed demo of what exactly I'm going to talk today. So I'm really, the title of my presentation is essentially smart change. So what is really happening today, if you really see? There's a projection that in 2054, we're going to have about 9 billion population. This literally means every new city is getting created every 5 days. Purchasing power is actually increasing out there. And all these things really pushes us to change. The old adage of change is constant is no more valid. We just can't say change is constant. We need to actually change smartly. Smart change is the thing, and this is what we're actually driving within Hexagon. And what we mean by smart chain, you know, it's a constant, it's a challenge for us as a source of motivation and growth, shaping business and industry landscape while we ensure that we increase the bottom line of this company and increase the competitive edge of our customers in the marketplace. So what are we really trying to do? So Hexagon is essentially a hardware and a software company. And if you're really looking at designing something new, we can start in a digital environment and simulate the whole digital environment and implement it in the real environment. But we want to kind of improve the existing infrastructure. We first need to capture the physical environment and take it to a digital environment, do your simulations and action around them, and go back to the physical environment and implement what exactly you've actually simulated out there in the digital environment. So what we're essentially talking about is just not smart vehicles or smart autonomous fleet. We are talking of connecting smart cities, smart mines, smart smart construction sites, smart plants, smart factories, all of them connected in an autonomous ecosystem that we really have. So it's a connected ecosystem that we actually built to connect all these different smart infrastructure that is out there in the marketplace. So I'll just give you a brief from MSC software. I really head the MSC software, which is one of the companies within the Hexagon portfolio. And MSC software has been around for more than 55 years. We have actually started off when NASA wanted to send a man to the moon way back in 1963. And you can't really make a physical prototype and test it. You need to really kind of simulate how to build that rocket, how the rocket could actually kind of go to the moon. So the MSC software was born. We actually simulated the whole experience of creating the rocket to send the man to the moon. And then we have been involved in the Mars mission, and we have replicated some of those things involved in the Indian space mission. So we have been involved in Chandrayaan, and we are also involved in the ISRO project in sending the man to the moon in 2022. So essentially, there is not a single vehicle out there in the market, not a single transportation system, not a single aircraft, not a single ship, which has not been impacted by MSC software. It's been a long journey for more than 55 years, and we have been simulating, and now we are adding value within the Hexagon portfolio and connecting the metrology piece of Hexagon portfolio. Essentially, once you simulate and create a parts, assemblies, create your products, measure the products so that whatever you design and whatever you're measuring, and is it really the same, and go back to the chain of essentially getting the product right first time to the market. So a lot of companies have actually been doing simulations using these products. The marquee customers in automotive, aerospace, shipbuilding, all the big names, these guys have all been simulation. So simulation essentially started off from the aerospace area, because they were not, they couldn't afford to build a prototype and test. Automotive companies have always been in the mode of build, test cycle. But today, automotive industry has actually learned from the experience of the aerospace industry, and they're doing a lot of simulations and essentially reducing the number of prototypes and increasing their bottom line and also ensuring that they're getting the product right first time that they actually design. So coming to the topic of this session, this seminar, this conference, there are two undeniable truths that I really want to talk about. Every speaker before me spoke about the need for innovation. I know in the morning we had Uma Mahesh talking even small innovations, like we have a long queue of people when they get off the bus, really kind of scan their attendance, and can we really kind of do some innovation so that as soon as he boards the bus, his attendance gets marked. And he talks about bigger innovations as well, and a lot of other speakers spoke about it. So innovation is the key. We need to constantly innovate at whatever we do. We need to ensure that we actually build better products in a faster time, more durable, more faster, more lighter, more, with the regulations coming in, more acoustic friendly, a lot of parameters. So innovation is actually a must today. We can't really kind of avoid that. But while doing all these things, we are generating so much amount of data. So data is the new oil. So we need to ensure that while we are doing all this innovation and generating huge amount of data, are we able to integrate all this data together and present it in a proper form for people to take decision on that? This data has to be actionable. We need to be able to take action on the data that gets generated, and this has to be presented in a particular way. So integration of the data becomes very, very critical so that you can actually take a decision. So in this fog of smart cities, when I really talk of smart cities, we are talking of digital cities, making the whole city digitized, and ensuring also the whole concept of safety. You know, I'm going back to the Tata Motors, even in the Ashok Leland presentation, where they said safety becomes extremely important. So while we are doing all these aspects of technology, how do we ensure that safety? So just to give you a brief, we have a product, we implemented a product in UP Police called UP100, which actually is a call and dispatch system. So any incident that is really happening, you actually call the police control room and how quickly police can dispatch and whether the incident can actually be kind of addressed to at that point of time or start tracking how much time does it take. So this has become so efficient today that during the last festival of Holi is typically the kind of a festival where there's a lot of incidents which is really happens out there. So UP police actually received more than 1 lakh incidents, more than 1 lakh calls, which was actually dispatched and addressed to on the same day. So this really talks about while you're actually creating a smart city, creating a digital city, we need to also take care of the safety aspect of it and how this whole thing is actually connected. The previous speaker here talked about, you know, we're talking of smart buildings, smart city infrastructure, and now we're talking about the car being in the center of this whole smart city infrastructure, talking to its peer vehicles, its neighboring vehicles, which is really going around it, plus the city infrastructure, whether it's a signpost, whether it's a building, and how this whole thing gets connected. So essentially, the concept of imagine a digital city, and we have an integrated operations and command center, and addressing the safety and security, smart utilities, and smart transportation, which is really focus of this particular seminar or the conference of connected vehicles. So extending this to, you know, the smart vehicle or the autonomous vehicle, and again, we had Sivasailam this morning, the Secretary of Commerce, talking about autonomous does not always mean driverless. There are different levels of autonomy. And level 2, level 3 autonomy can actually add a lot of value today. We need not go to level 5. That's going to be the future. It's really coming, but you can actually go in stage by stage. So there's a huge paradigm shift that is really happening when we're really talking about autonomous vehicles. Okay? When you are the driver, you have vehicle controls, you have things like ABS really kind of helping you, and it is extending to advanced driving assistance. We are moving to a structure where the car is the driver. And depending on the level of autonomy, whether it's actually level 3, you know, the car becomes a driver in some conditions, where if it is level 5, the car becomes autonomous every year, every time. So the huge paradigm shift which is really happening. So till now, when we are doing simulation of these cars, we were actually simulating how good the car is, how good the ride and handling is. We didn't have to worry what decision the driver had to take. We now have to actually simulate, you know, the person sitting behind the wheel, what decision he has to take depending on the different scenarios that he's actually encountering out there. So these certification requires training and testing. So if you have to be certified to drive in the road today, the human driver goes through a driving school, there's a driving simulator, there is a proving ground, there is a test out there, then you get a license and you are certified to drive. But if you have an artificial intelligence driver, you need a lot of situations, a lot of scenarios. The car should be able to do, you should be able to predict the actions that the car takes in different conditions. And you need to actually physically test it to some extent. There's a limitation to the number of tests that you can actually do today, but simulation is actually kind of becoming the key in the autonomous space. And then once you get certified, then the car gets a license to drive. So this is a shift which is really happening. So the car goes through the same thing as the human go through, but in a completely different way. So essentially, you have the road test, you have the proving ground, and then you have the simulation. So just to give you an example, the Google company has actually physically tested 16 million kilometers in 10 years. That's a limitation, right? You can only have, there are certain speeds which it can actually drive, which is actually certified. Of course, things are changing a little bit. But when it comes to simulation, it is able to simulate 13 million kilometers per day. So you can actually simulate different scenarios, the actions that the car has to take. And if these different scenarios are actually fed in through an AI engine, so when the car actually faces a situation where it has not been simulated, the AI can actually have a predictable model to actually kind of tell the car that these are the similar situations where the action was taken in this particular way, and maybe this is the action that you could actually take. And 90% of the time, it kind of is true. So simulation is the key. We really don't have that much of time to really do a physical test. And today's simulations are getting more and more accurate, more and more realistic, and people are actually going in the simulation way for the autonomous space. So if you really look at it, Google today, they have got a certification from a regulatory authority to drive their autonomous cars in California at speeds up to 65 miles per hour. And this is really common, in October of 2018. This is a major, major development. So an autonomous car can really drive at 65 miles per hour and actually behave exactly the way we behave, or maybe in some cases even better than we behave in the road conditions. So putting all these components together, so you have the sensors model, getting the data from the external environment. It could be the static objects, it could be dynamic objects, the vehicle model that we really have, the 3D environment, and the test and data management. And then we can combine all these things together and provide a solution to the auto manufacturers from a hardware and a software perspective and put this, all these components together out there. So just to expand what I'm really talking about in the autonomous space, if you really look at the left-hand side, these are all the hardware system. So we have the hardware system to map the roads, map the whole city, the hardware system to really kind of map the exact position of the vehicle, what is the exact coordinates of the vehicle through the Navotil system, which is part of Hexagon PI. We have amongst with us Rahul, who actually heads the Hexagon PI. He can talk more about it. And then on the right-hand side is the software system, which is the Virus VTD, part of our software for autonomous design. And then we have the Adams, the leading vehicle dynamics product. And Adams has to really kind of work faster than real time. What I mean faster than real time is you can't really afford to kind of have a lag between the simulation and the action that has to take based on the simulation results that the product actually kind of predicts. So Adams integrated with Virus, integrated with the data management system, integrated the hardware, is a complete solution that is really available today. It's a reality today for the autonomous market space. So coming to converting the hardware side, converting the physical roads to digital roads. So with the LiDAR cameras, which you actually see on the left-hand side, that equipment which is sitting on top of the car, roughly having about 9 cameras, we are able to analyze about 1 kilometer in just about 60 seconds. So you're able to scan the complete roads and feed it into the database, and that can be saved into the VTD software that we really have. The whole city can be mapped, the whole city can be scanned, which we have actually done. And these are all data inputs for the autonomous car, to help the autonomous car, to simulate the autonomous car behavior in these cities, in these road conditions that we really have. So then we have this Novotel system which can actually predict, which can actually locate exactly the position of the car, the position of the vehicle in different places, the exact coordinates, which will really kind of help us where is a vehicle with reference to the environment that is there, which is also a required input for the simulation area. So getting all these things together, so you can actually map your static objects. It could be roads, it could be bridges, or you could actually map those sensor data, the data which is really coming from the cameras, or dynamic objects like signpost, and you have the pedestrian moving in, the speed breakers, or the difficult weather conditions like snow conditions. You can map this whole thing environment and start working on the simulation, how the car should actually behave. So essentially extending this to the sensors which is installed on the car, which is starting to scan not only the physical objects out there, it is also starting to scan the other cars. It could be a school bus, it could be a police van. There has to be some kind of intelligence built in. What if there is a school bus in front of you? What should be your speed? What if there is a police van actually kind of chasing the car? What actions it has to be taken? So all those informations and all will be scanned and actually fed into the system out there. Now, taking this step a bit further, we're not only trying to actually scan the road as it is, we are trying to put some intelligence into it. What's the texture of the road? Whether there's a water on the road, whether there is a, if you have a very bright sunlight out there, sometimes some of these cameras may not be able to kind of capture the situation. So we have a physics-based rendering system so that you can increase your perception of what exactly is there in the environment, which can help you in the simulation of this activity. Now, some of these sensors in the car, when the car is vibrating, there could be some dust in the lenses, or there could be some water on the lenses, there could be some errors. So what we are doing is we're actually introducing some errors into the system and redefining those methodology, those technology, the software, so that it can actually capture these errors and eliminate some of these errors and work on the real data and not work on the data which is actually kind of fed with some of these errors is actually built in. Now, coming to the software side, as I was talking about earlier, the Adams product, which is the vehicle dynamics or the multi-body dynamics, as we really call it, and it is completely integrated into the autonomous design software, autonomous simulation software, which is Virus VTD, as we really talk it. So this is where you can actually simulate. Once you can simulate within the lab environment, or you can simulate in a proving ground environment with a virtual headset or vehicle in loop, hardware in loop, driver in loop kind of a concept, while she's actually driving in a proving ground, but the virtual headset is actually giving a perception of a city through which she's driving, and all these data can be simulated, and it can be fed, and it will help the car to actually take an action in the situation that is actually facing in the real world out there. So while we have all these cars talking to each other, we are calling connected vehicles, cars talking to cars, cars talking to smart city infrastructure, we need to ensure that we have some standards out there. Because if you are not going to have standards, these communications have no meaning. So we have actually helped Working with the various division within the MSC software with the automotive companies are actually working to have worked to create standards, open drive, which is essentially the roads and the what kind of data that it should be stored. Open CRG, what I was talking about, the texture of the roads, how that has to be served, how that has to be saved, so that people can you can actually talk to different vehicles in that same format. An open scenario, how that has to be saved, and how that can be communicated between the connected vehicles out there. So we have two major bodies out there. Pegasus is more related to the automotive world. So we have all these European OEMs, and of course, our division, Virus, and the government also funded some money into it program, and we have developed some standards out there. And this is one more evolving standard, which is Enable S3. And this focuses not just on the automotive space. It focuses on farming. It focuses on rail. It focuses on aerospace, health, maritime. And we are creating some standards for all this equipment as well. So this is a slightly bigger group. And there is a bigger funding to it. And we have actually worked for the last 3 years and built standards to ensure that every vehicle manufacturer out there is actually saving the data in this standard format so that we can actually exchange information accurately, and there's no distortion of information happening. So this is, again, a hardware company within the group, Autonomous Stuff, which can actually provide this industry best products. It could be different toolkits which can be provided to an automaker to help him to build an autonomous car, or we could actually build the whole car for you. We could actually sell the whole autonomous car for you. Or you can get one of your cars. We can actually use this autonomous stuff kit and put it into your car and make your stuff autonomous. So essentially, there's so much of data that is really coming in. And if you really look at data, I would like to, coming from sensors, streaming, virtualization, all these things coming into play. So essentially, I would like to take this data into six major components. Edge computing, essentially computing on the premises, mobility, artificial intelligence, cloud, enterprise, visualization, and all these connected through an IoT platform, Exalt, which are really built, and so that we can actually communicate having the same protocol at these different applications. So these things can be driven through an app on your phone, through the enterprise, and this whole thing is powered by this IoT platform out there. So this is a smart mine which is existing in Australia today. It's a reality today, successfully running using this whole technology. And these smart vehicles in the integrated ecosystem of smart cities, and we're really helping enabling companies to kind of develop their autonomous strategy using the hardware and software within the group. Thank you so much.